Hello, I'm Jonathan Moyes, Head of Investment Research at Wealth Club, and today I'm with Christopher Pease and Josh Northrop of Whitman Asset Management to talk about the Whitman AIM IHT service. Hello, welcome both to the studio. Chris, if we could start with you. Could you introduce us to Whitman Asset Management and your own experience?
Certainly could. First of all, thank you very much for having us on the programme. And I'm Christopher Pease, and I came together with a few like-minded individuals about 4 years ago and helped get Whitman Asset Management off the ground. Our ethos is really very much smaller cap focused, UK smaller cap focused. We run an AIM portfolio as well as a quoted UK small cap growth fund. We also have a private client arm, but the majority of our 100 million or so in assets is in the small cap space. I myself have around about 40 years experience. I first came into the city in 1982. I started at Henderson Administration, as it was then, and then moved on to Saracen, where I started our AIM IHT service back in 2009. So quite a number of years experience on doing these AIM portfolios. I'll hand over to Josh.
I'm Joshua Northrop, and I have not got 40 years experience like Christopher, but I do have 10 years experience. I spent 5 years before coming to Whitman at Hargreave Hale, which was a small cap specialist boutique that managed a number of different strategies in small cap. That business actually has since been acquired by Canaccord. And I left Hargreave Hale to co-found Whitman with Christopher and a few other like-minded souls at the end of 2018, and really jumped at the opportunity to kind of build a boutique that specialised in smaller cap investing.
So we're here today to talk about the AIM IHT service. Chris, could you tell us more about the service and what it aims to do for investors?
Yes. Well, I very much make a point of telling all investors who want to hear about it that we are first and foremost choosing a portfolio of high quality UK smaller cap growth stocks. It just so happens that this portfolio qualifies for these great tax breaks on inheritance tax. It also actually qualifies from tax break on paying no stamp duty, which saves you about 0.5% when you buy these stocks. But if you're not happy with being in a portfolio of small cap, UK small cap growth stocks, you shouldn't really be in the service. To my mind, the inheritance tax break is kind of icing on the cake, a very important icing, but we make a point of being investment led rather than being tax led when we're talking to new clients.
Sure. And Josh, what types of companies are you looking to invest in?
So we are first and foremost looking for growth companies, and we're sort of targeting businesses that we think can grow their earnings around 10% or more for the foreseeable future. We like companies with a reasonable amount of predictability around their earnings, so you know, relatively easy to forecast year in, year out. Once we've found a business that we think can grow with a reasonable amount of predictability, we have three key investment criteria that kind of form the bedrock to our investment process. And in the center of it is what we call exceptional management team with meaningful equity alignment. And what we really mean by that is management teams that have a proven track record of capital allocation, use debt very conservatively, and have skin in the game. So on average, our companies are about 12% owned by the management teams, which gives them great alignment to us as investors. The second key investment criteria is strong and sustainable competitive advantage, which we define as stable and above average margins and cash return on invested capital. So our average margins are EBITDA margins around 25% and average cash return on capital of around 25% across the portfolio. And the third is high and predictable levels of cash generation. So we like businesses with low levels of working capital and lots of recurring revenue. And the idea is that you have cash profit coming out of the business, excellent management teams allocating that cash at a high rate of return. And the cycle is virtuous and continues. But key is excellent management team, because they're the people that make the capital allocation decisions.
And that skin in the game.
And that skin in the game helps us, you know, gives us comfort that they're aligned. But we want to find management teams that are, you know, have exceptional knowledge in their industry, have been doing it for a long period of time, and have a lot of skin in the game.
And are there any companies that you look to avoid, or any sectors that you avoid?
Yeah, absolutely. So we don't invest in loss-making companies. We don't invest in companies below 100 million market cap. Our view is that below 100 million, you're also finding liquidity it can be a problem. And investors coming into smaller caps typically are taking a reasonable amount of risk anyway. So we don't want to add to that by going into businesses where the natural level of liquidity is very low. So we have a 100 million market cap minimum. We don't invest in companies where the revenues are very out of control, out of the control of the management team. Mm-hmm. So businesses like life science companies that are trying to develop drugs, where the outcome is quite binary to an extent, or commodity exploration companies we're not particularly interested in. And we generally don't invest in companies with low margins as well. So we have avoided a lot of the online retailers, businesses where margins can easily be eroded.
So could you give us some examples of companies you have backed recently within the portfolio?
Yeah, so a recent investment we made in the AIM portfolios is a company called Tracsis, which we've actually known for a while as we've been invested in the small cap. We've had a position in the small cap fund for a while, so it wasn't new to us, but it's new to the AIM strategy. It's got a market cap of around, I think, about 275 million at the moment, and it's a business that sells planning and performance measurement software and hardware to the rail industry predominantly. That's actually been on AIM since 2005 when it spun out from Leeds University. It's since grown organically at just below 20% annually. We think has a phenomenal runway of growth ahead of it, both organically, but also through making additional acquisitions. And we think they can easily double the size of their UK rail operation. And that's business that, yeah, so we're very fond of that company.
And what about some of the more established holdings within the portfolio, companies you've held for a long time?
So business we've held for quite a long time is a company called Lok’N Store, which is the market cap, I think it's just shy of 300 million now. And that's the fourth largest self-storage operator in the UK. They've got about 40 self-storage facilities that they manage, and they both own some of the sites and do an operational model as well. The barriers to entry are quite high to that sector. You need about £10 million to actually develop a site. But once you have a site, they're very, very profitable at about 50% EBITDA margins and will continue to generate great cash for many years to come. They've got a pipeline of 12 more sites, which will add about 50% capacity to their existing capacity. And it's founder-led, run by its founder, with he still owns 25% of the company. So we think it's a great business.
And we've seen recently, obviously, the AIM market's become a little bit more volatile, falling in line with global stock markets. Chris, how has this affected your portfolio and how it's performed?
Yeah, I mean, it has been, the AIM index, it's down sort of over 30% year to date. So it's been one of the worst performing asset classes. Of any asset class, you know, no matter where you go in the world. But we have seen this sort of volatility before, and what tends to happen is the recovery is an awful lot sharper than the other asset classes, just as the downside's been sharper, so will the upside be sharper. I mean, the important thing as far as we as investment managers are concerned is to hold your nerve, obviously, be absolutely sure that you're in the sort of companies that Josh has explained, with the right products and services and strong management and strong balance sheets. And as I say, just stick with them, and sentiment will turn. I mean, one of the problems is that in the last few months is that money has been coming out of the sector generally through open-ended funds, have been selling stocks which often are in people's AIM portfolios like ours. So it's not that the actual underlying company has done anything wrong particularly, but it's just the weight of money selling out from good stocks from people who require the liquidity. But that will recover, it always has done, and we expect it to recover over the next 12 months.
So the changing environment isn't affecting the way you invest at all?
I would say that we are always reassessing the portfolio, literally on a daily basis, to judge whether the sort of stocks we have are the right ones for this environment. And there's no doubt that right now, say, the consumer is more challenged than they have been for a number of years, with prices going up and their bills going up, and they won't have so much to spend. That has been discounted very effectively and very quickly in the market prices, say, of the internet retailers, which are listed on AIM. So it's very much a moving story. I equate it really to painting a picture, having a portfolio, that if you're an artist and you're painting a picture, you've sort of never finished. And you can never say, right, that's my portfolio, I'm done and dusted. You know, every day, and that's what makes the job fun, really. Every day, the circumstances are changing, and that gives you another angle on a stock, maybe a new stock or a stock you already hold. So it's a continual process of just touching up and reassessing every single stock in the portfolio.
What are you finding most challenging at present?
Well, I think it's true to say that business models have can go out of date quicker than they ever have on before, but that increasingly creates new opportunities for business models which are more attractive than they've been. But clearly the macro environment is quite challenging. You've got, I mean, just pretending if you're running a company, you've got problems with the input side of long supply chains and not knowing what the costs of goods are going to be that are coming in. And then you've got problems on the demand side, which is to do with to what extent people will have the money to buy your goods and services. And overarching those two, you've had the political issues, which is not something that we've typically had in the last 10 years, but you've had political issues both on the domestic front, which obviously spooked the market with the change in governments in the UK, and political problems, obviously, internationally with Ukraine, which has changed a lot of the input prices for companies. So you've had all these three problems, which again have meant that we have to look at every single company and say, to what extent are they affected by these issues?
So we've touched on earlier the types of companies you like to buy. What do you look for when looking to sell a stock? What's the typical reasons for selling a stock in the portfolio?
So we have quite a tight portfolio of around about 25 stocks. And if a new stock comes through, there haven't been any new issues much this year. There were quite a few last year. But if a new issue comes through, or indeed a new stock comes through, which has perhaps been too small for us earlier on, but has risen up the market cap scale, and we think looks interesting, it has the sort of characteristics that Josh was talking about. And we feel that it's strong enough a story to be put into the portfolio. We then say, okay, what's got to leave the portfolio, because we don't want to push it up above 25 stocks. So that's one reason. But similarly, if one of our companies makes an acquisition which we're not too sure about, or there's a change in management and we're not too sure about that. So basically the fundamentals of that company that we've invested in change, then that might mean that we'd say, actually, we're not so happy with having this in the portfolio and we'll get rid of it.
So Chris, how risky is investing in AIM?
Well, risk can be viewed in a lot of different ways. What is risky to one person isn't necessarily risky to another person. But when people say AIM portfolios are risky, what they're normally referring to is that they are pretty volatile. And actually this year would back that up. Clearly, the AIM portfolios have been more volatile than other asset classes. But the important thing, as far as we're concerned at Whitman, is to try and mitigate or reduce that risk. And the ways we try and do that is, first of all, to know our companies in the portfolio absolutely backwards, so that we know, or we think we will know, the way that those companies will react to whatever economic circumstances are thrown up. So we get to know them as others do, by visiting them and meeting the managements on a regular basis. We also have a higher market cap than some other fund managers do in this space. So our typical market cap is north of 500 million, our average market cap. We have some smaller stocks, certainly, but that is the average. And that gives us a little bit more liquidity, and means that as we're comparatively small compared with some of the octopuses of this world, we can move in and out of positions much more easily than other people can.
So finally, to sum up, if someone's looking to invest in an AIM IHT portfolio service this year, why should they choose the Whitman AIM IHT service?
Well, I think we have, as a team, a lot of experience. There's three of us that work on the strategy full time, as well as our small cap fund. And as you have heard, Christopher has been doing it for a very long time. So I think we've got a lot of experience. But equally important, we are also quite small. We've only been going for 4 years as a business, and this strategy only has £40 million in it. So we think a combination of very experienced team, but with a small strategy, gives us a really unique advantage versus a lot of our peers. And to date, since we've launched, our performance has been strong relative to our peers. So we're excited about our size. I think the fact that we are all aligned very clearly with our investors and clients, we're all owners of equity in Whitman and have invested in our strategies heavily. So this is very much our business to grow alongside our investors. So we really do care about the success of the strategies as well. I think that's the other kind of key USP about Whitman Asset Management.
Very good. Chris Pease and Josh Northrop of Whitman Asset Management, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.